Professor Yulia Kovas. She's a professor of genetics and psychology at the Goldsmith University of London, and she's the director of the in-lab at the Goldsmith College. She's an honorary researcher at the Institute of Psychiatry, where she leads the mathematics research on twins' early development study, exploring gene-environment interplay in shaping individual variation in mathematic interest, ability and achievement. She's also established a laboratory for cognitive investigation and behavioral genetics at Tomsk State University, where she directs a major international scientific research program. She has published extensively on gene-environment interplay involved in variation in mathematics in many leading journals, as well as presented many international conferences. And today she'll be giving us a talk entitled Genetic and Environmental Underpinning of Individual Differences in Learning Abilities.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm very excited to be here. It's been a fantastic conference. I feel like I'm in a tough spot here, both because I followed the excellent talk with fantastic results, and also something that I feel is very relevant to what a lot of people are doing here. I'm not sure how the work that I'm going to present to you is relevant to your current research, but potentially relevant for your future plans. And I say that because I believe that behavioral genetic research is a relative newcomer to the field of education and learning and cognitive psychology and learning abilities and disabilities, but it's definitely not going away. We live in the genomic era where new discoveries about genes are made every day. And just to kind of make an important statement is that behavioral genetics is the fastest growing field in the history of human science. So I really do think that we will see more and more progress in this field, and I will try to show you in this relatively short space of time how much we've learned in a very short period of time, and really how much we still have to learn. It's a vastly unexplored field. And finally, I'm very pleased that my talk is not the last, and we have to look forward to another fantastic talk with a very enigmatic title of whether we can improve our intelligence. So I feel that you're all here partly because we all want to know whether we can. Okay, so the behavioral genetic now it's called really behavioral genomic research program is an attempt to really trace the path from gene to behavior, and it's a very complex research field that has to go through all of the processes from from the single cell that contains our whole genome, through all the biological, psychological, and various other processes to explain individual differences in behavior. So behavioral genetics is there to understand why people differ in behavior and, in our case, learning abilities and disabilities. And of course, there are multiple factors, and I'm not here to explain this model, but there are multiple factors that interact with each other. Genes and environments don't work in isolation. They really, it's a very complex system, and I will just give you a few examples of this one. So I will start with just introducing a few behavioral genetic methods. So I'll start with quantitative genetic methods, and I will finish with molecular genetic research. So these here you see the quantitative genetic behavioral genetic research. It involves lots of different methods. It has a lot of methods in its repertoire, from classical twin studies, where monozygotic and dizygotic twins are being compared, to adoption design, sibling designs, the relative newcomer IVF design, where we can look at the families where children are conceived through in vitro fertilization. And this is a very interesting design. I won't have time to tell you about it more, but if you think about it, there are five different groups of relatives that are created in that design of different genetic and environmental relatedness. So the parents could both be biological parents of a child, only one parent can be biological parent, and none of the parents could be biological parents. And comparing these different groups of relatives, you can learn a lot about prenatal postnatal environment and genetic factors in their influences on development. And of course, so twin method has been around the longest out of these designs. It's very informative, and I've been very lucky to work on this particular study, twins early development study, in London for over 8 years. And this is a unique study. It has been going on for 18 years. This study involves approximately 7,500 pairs of twins, which is totally representative of the UK population. So all twins who were born in 3 consecutive years, 1994, 95, and 96, were invited through their parents, of course, to participate in this study. And 7,500 pairs of them have been consistently involved in this study for 18 years. And this study is dedicated to really the primary focus of this study is learning. So child learning behavior, cognitive abilities and disabilities, and other behavioral phenotypes. So this study has produced a lot of data, and I'll just show you some snippets of this data. And if you're interested to learn more about this study, there is this publication. It's a whole little book that describes the study up until 2007. But of course, now it's getting really old. So our children are not children anymore. They're 18 years this year. And in the last 4 years, I have established a kind of a partner study to that, to the UK study, the Russian School Twin Registry. So this study is not a birth cohort like a UK study. You probably understand that to establish a birth cohort of that magnitude, you need limited resources and a lot of expertise and power. But the Russian School Twin Registry involves children from 7 to 17, and it's also a longitudinal design. It's just starting, so we're hoping that that will be a good partner study to the UK study. And another thing I want to mention is that we, of course, from these children in the UK study, we have thousands of data points being collected on all kinds of measures. So some of the measures that we had presentations on about attention, number sense, reading, decoding, comprehension, and many, many, many other measures have been measured in the twins early development study. And apart from all those measures, and also measures on environment and many other things, we collect children's DNA. So for the UK children, we have DNA from every single child. And the DNA collection today is very cheap. And it doesn't involve any problems, no blood is necessary. All you need is a kit like this. It's a saliva collection kit, it's very cheap. You can store it at room temperature for 2 years. So it really doesn't require anything, just a little bit of money. And today we say to all our collaborators, even if you are not interested in genetics, really, if you have a sample that you have extensive data on, if it's a longitudinal design, then it will cost you very little to have DNA, and you might have a wealth of data in your data set one day. Okay. So, and what you can do with this DNA? Well, you don't have to do anything. You can just keep it for a long time. You can investigate single genes, for example, candidate genes. There are many methods that I'll tell you a little bit later about that allow you to genotype these samples for thousands of SNPs at the same time. I'll explain the SNPs with DNA markers. Or, in the future, we will be able to sequence the entire genome of every individual in your sample very cheaply. It's still very expensive today, but in the future it will be very cheap. And finally, you will be able to do everything that you are doing only in a genetically informative design. For example, if you're interested in whatever reading or mathematical processes in the brain and you're using an EEG study, you can also incorporate it into either twin design, or if you don't have twins, you can incorporate it in the molecular genetic design. Okay, so now I'll just give you a few examples that might be counterintuitive and something you probably didn't expect about genetics, and these are data that are coming out recently from several studies in the world and show this consistent pattern of results. So first of all, I hope you all know what heritability is, but I'll remind you what that might be. So heritability refers to the contribution of genes to the variability in a particular trait. So if we ask, if I ask you how heritable is reading, what do I mean? Well, I mean, to what extent are individual differences in people in a particular population are explained by their genetic differences. Okay? So, and what is heritability already? Anybody? Okay, well, I'll show you this bit. Yeah?
When the environment is constant.
Yeah. How much?
Homogeneous environment.
So, that is a very good observation, and I'll tell you a little bit later. Heritability of a particular trait differs as a function of environment. So, if an environment is very homogeneous, then heritability is usually higher. So, and we'll talk about it a little bit later. But another question is, how heritable is intelligence, for example? Why do people differ in general cognitive ability? And so many people have different answers to that, and today we know that actually there is no straightforward answer to that. And for many reasons, but one of the reasons is that heritability of intelligence increases with age. So, for example, when children are very young, the differences in children in heritability are actually largely environmental. But as we grow older, individual differences in intelligence across people become largely explained by genetic factors. And this increase is stable and reaches very high levels in adulthood. So individual differences in adults in general cognitive ability have a lot to do with differences in their DNA. And this is not a particularly intuitive finding. So in fact, when we asked people before the study, what do you think? Many people thought that heritability would be higher in childhood. Somehow people thought, well, that's somehow closer to the genes or something. But that makes no sense. You know, our genes are always with us. But why can heritability increase? And I'll tell you what the hypothesis is. So this particular study has been replicated several times in many populations and in many, many twin samples. It shows the same pattern. Heritability of intelligence increases with age. And we recently did this study where we looked at three different phenotypes: literacy, numeracy, and general cognitive ability in children at age 7, 9, and 12. And what we showed is, again, a very consistent pattern that many twin samples replicated in the world. Literacy and numeracy are consistently quite highly heritable. So approximately 60% in reading ability and mathematical ability in school children is explained by genetic differences. But general cognitive ability heritability starts quite low and gradually increases with age. By age 12, it's indistinguishable from heritability for literacy and numeracy. So here, again, you will show seemingly counterintuitive results. Many people believe that general cognitive ability, or IQ, is more heritable than achievement. But that's not the case. Many studies have shown the opposite result. IQ is less heritable in childhood than achievement. And for that, again, I will show you some potential explanations, but one of them is because many different factors contribute to a child's achievement at school, and each one of these factors is partly heritable. So, but why is this increase in heritability? So the leading hypothesis today is the so-called gene-environment correlation. So people, environments don't just happen to us. People select, modify, and actively create their own environments partly because of who they are. And when children are little, they have less opportunity to create and modify their own environments than when people are adults. So our choices that we make in life and the situations that we put ourselves and the way we perceive the world actually reinforces our initial genetic propensities. And therefore, heritabilities grow rather than decrease. Okay, so we've heard a little bit today about the kind of approximate number sense, it's called. So it's one of these abilities that we share with many different species. So it's this ability to kind of appreciate the number in terms of more or less and extract this information from environment. So it's seemingly a very important evolutionarily conserved traits. So this rat, for example, can see where there are more dots. Animals generally, in foraging behavior, they can see where there is more food, etc. And the Amazonian tribes, I'm sure you heard about, those who don't have in their language exact numbers and therefore they fail at exact mathematical tasks, they have no problems with approximate number judgments. So it's clearly an evolutionarily conserved task. So we wanted to know, and we also know that you know, the number sense develops, that little children very, very, very early on already can make discriminations and numerosities, and that already little children differ in their ability to discriminate numerosities, and this kind of precision of this discrimination. And these individual differences are observed in other populations as well. So what we wanted to know is, what is heritability of number sense? So what is the relative contribution of genetic and environmental factors to this trait? And when we asked people who work in this field to make a prediction, we said, what do you think? Will it be highly heritable or highly environmental? And actually, people like Justin Alberder and many other people and who work with the approximation, they predicted that it will be highly heritable. They said it's evolutionarily conserved, animals have it, humans have it, so it's something to do with genes. Well, we did this study, and what we found, so this is this task, dot task, where you know, children had to select bigger or smaller number, they had to, in this particular case, well, it was blue and yellow dots, the famous task, and children needed to say were there more yellow dots or blue dots. And the task is very fast, it's just flashing, and a lot of the time people feel that they're guessing, but actually they're not. And so what we found is that, so A is heritability. The heritability of number sense, and this is another task that kind of job is approximate numerosity, is much lower than many other heritabilities, than mathematics, IQ, reading, language. It was actually one of the lowest heritabilities we've ever seen. And so that kind of didn't make sense at first, but then it made perfect sense. So our hypothesis for that explanation is this, that this is a very important evolutionary conserved task, and therefore nature works through natural selection, it actually works at prohibiting genetic variability that provides individual differences on this task. So through natural selection, actually variability is not allowed. You need to have number sense, you need to have sufficient number sense, and therefore genetic variability for this task is not allowed. So it's kind of screened away from natural selection. And this is this brings me to a very important point. So the sources of a particular individual differences in the trait don't have to be the same with the reasons for why we have this trait. So for example, we all have noses, that is because we have human DNA, and we all have language because we have human DNA, but the differences in our noses or in our language may be entirely environmental or entirely genetic or both. So individual differences don't have to stem from the same factors. And so with this particular data, we showed that individual variability in number sense are largely environmental. What they are, we don't know. They don't have anything to do with genes. Another important kind of finding that we've shown again and again and again in behavioral genetics is this generalist effect. So when you have a data set with a lot of data, like if you have data on reading, on language, on mathematics, on attention, on all kinds of things, and it's a twin study, you can ask the question whether it is the same genes that contribute to all these different traits, or different genes, and the same about environments. Are these the same environments that contribute, let's say, to reading variability and mathematical variability, or different environments? And what we have shown many times is that actually there is a huge amount of overlap in the genetic effects on these different traits. So to a large extent, the same genetic factors contribute to differences in reading abilities and mathematical ability and general cognitive ability and a whole range of other cognitive phenotypes. And gradually we came to think that, first of all, that genetic effects are pleiotropic. Pleiotropy means that the same genes contribute to many different traits. It's a biological fact. And what makes child's, for example, performance different, so let's say I read better than I calculate, that these differences largely come from environments. And we don't really know why and which kind of environments are important for that. But genetically, there is a lot of very common genetic effects. And so because we did this study on number sense and mathematics, What we wanted to see is this correlation that has been regularly shown in the literature. It's not always there, not at all ages, not at all samples, but it keeps coming up in the literature that this ability to approximate number and mathematical abilities are somehow correlated. And there are various hypotheses about why that might be, whether one drives the other, or whether the third factor drives all of them, or something else. But in a twin sample, you can just ask the question whether this correlation is there because of genetic effects, the same genes contribute to this correlation, or the same environment. And this study has not been published yet. It's the only study that has been done so far in a twin sample looking at the number sense and mathematical ability. But what we are showing is that despite the fact that mathematics is quite highly heritable, and number sense only shows low heritability, this correlation between the two is largely explained by genetic factors. So whatever this is, whatever the mediating process is in the brain or cognitive, is it attention or something else, but they are genetically underscored. Another thing is that we've done quite a lot of work on learning disability. So remember that the Twins Early Development Study in London is totally representative of the population. So, and that means that we can study disability in the context of ability. So we can ask questions whether disability is etiologically linked to ability. So, and the prevalence of all learning disabilities is similar to the UK population in our studies. So we have similar prevalence of dyslexia, dyscalculia, whatever you want to define, specific language impairment, etc. And so, first of all, what we have shown is that heritability estimates and environmental influences are very similar for variability in ability in the normal range and for disability. So, for example, individual differences in reading are approximately 60% genetic and 40% environmental. And the etiology of dyslexia is very similar. It's approximately 60% genetic and 40% environmental in a particular population, in the UK population. Remember that you can only estimate within a particular population. And then we asked the question about these overlaps in etiology for disabilities. We showed a very similar pattern to abilities. So these things in blue are the common genetic effects on different disabilities. So reading, language, mathematics, some others. So there is a very large amount of genetic overlap. So the same set of genes seem to be contributing to all of these different disorders. All right, and I don't have time to talk about it, but there is a paper that recently came out on mathematical anxiety. So just like I showed you with number sense, what we have done is ask the question, to the extent that mathematical anxiety and mathematical performance correlate, is this correlation there for genetic or for environmental reasons? And again, we're showing that largely this correlation is there for genetic reasons. What they are doing, exactly what these genes act for, we don't know. It could be causal. So, for example, performance affects anxiety, and whatever genes contribute to performance also contribute to anxiety. It could be like this. Or pleiotropic. So, these genes affect both anxiety and performance without anything in between. Or some other mechanism, which we don't know about yet, but it's definitely worth exploring. So, another question that we asked is this motivation. So, I'm sure you work with teachers, maybe some of our teachers, and we all know that motivation is important. And many studies have shown that motivation and interest and etc. are connected somehow with performance. But actually, there is still, we really don't know how they are connected, what is the longitudinal processes, and there are probably a lot of reciprocal links. But in this particular study, what we did is we measured mathematical achievement at age 9, self-evaluation, where we had mathematical interest, self-perceived ability, and enjoyment of mathematics. And then again, the same kind of self-evaluation, enjoyment, interest at age 12, and mathematical achievement at age 12. And what we wanted to see is whether there is a link between mathematical motivation, broadly speaking, at age 9, and mathematical achievement at age 12, controlling for self-evaluation at age 12. So is this a link from motivation to achievement across development? And what we found that indeed there was a correlation from enjoyment and interest and self-perceivability to mathematical achievement three years later. The correlation was small but highly significant, and bear in mind that this is after controlling for general cognitive ability and many other things, so it's a true correlation. But again, what we found, and that was the real surprise to us, is that this correlation is also mediated by common genetic factors. So what's happening there, again, we don't know. But there seem to be a large set of genes that contributes to both motivation and achievement. Okay, and one more piece of evidence for motivation. This is our latest study. It's just come out. It pulled together 13,000 pairs of twins from six different countries. And we wanted to ask this question generally. What is the etiology of kind of self-perceived ability and enjoyment in different subjects? So this is just part of the table. There are lots of tables in this monograph, because we really pulled across ages, across academic subjects, across six different countries. And so this is just an example. These are monozygotic twin pairs. So these are children who growing up in the same family, they have identical DNA, and they taught in the same classroom, in this column, and in different classrooms in this column. Actually, our UK sample provided to us this unique possibility to compare twins who study in the same classroom and twins who study in two different classrooms, because in the UK it's a decision of parents where they put their children, and half of our sample put their children with the same teacher and half with different teachers. It's not as simple as that, because there are also some streaming effects. So if one child is weaker in one subject than another, they might be put in another class, etc. So, but anyway, we have this unique comparison. And again, it is kind of shocking. So remember, genetically identical children who go to the same classroom and learn and live in the same home. How similar are they in their motivation for different subjects, and their enjoyment of different subjects, and their self-perceivability for different subjects? Not very much. So monozygotic twins are much less similar in motivation than they are in achievement. So the correlations are only about 40%, so 30-40%, which suggests that largely individual differences in children in motivational factors come from non-shared environmental factors that don't operate by making them the same in the same family, but factors that make them different in the same family, whatever these factors are. And now have a look at this. So these are monozygotic children who are taught in the same classroom and in different classrooms. There is absolutely no difference in their similarity. So they're just as similar to each other as when they're taught by the same teacher or different teachers. So that again suggests that something in the environment contributes to their dissimilarities much more than to their similarities. So that was quite an interesting result. It was absolutely consistent across the countries, subjects, everything. All right, one more piece of evidence from twin studies, and I'll tell you a little bit about molecular genetics. So this is again one of our latest papers, and this is, remember I told you our twins are now 18, but this study we've done when they were 16. So we collected data from these children on their exam performance at the end of their formal education. So at age 16, all children in the UK take this exam. It's called General Certificate for Secondary Education. So all children take it in mathematics, language, English, and then they can take it in several other subjects. So we took the core subjects, science, mathematics, English, and then we took many other exams, but here I'm just looking. So these are GCSE exams in maths, science, and English, pulled together, because the results are practically identical. And what we also did is collected data from these same children on many, many different things. So we had 85 different measures. So here I'm just showing pulled together. So self-efficacy, general intelligence, school environment, home environment, personality measures, well-being, their perception of, so this is the child-reported behavior problems, health, and many other things. And so the purpose of this study was several things. So one, we wanted to understand what predicts a child's performance on these GCSE exams at age 16. So what are the best predictors of that performance? Well, we kind of knew from previous research that intelligence will be one of the best predictors. But actually it turned out that intelligence explained about only... So first of all the measures, 85 measures together, explained 45% of exam performance, including intelligence, motivation, and everything else. To me, it's actually quite shocking, because what is the other 55% of unexplained variable in this very important exam? This exam actually determines children's, lots of children's outcomes. So, and only 45% of that is explained by 85 different measures that are very reliable. So, then half of that was explained by individual differences in intelligence. And the other half by all of these other measures pulled together. So another thing that you can see here is that exam performance, so the red bars are heritability, so the extent to which individual differences in performance is explained by genes. So it's quite heritable. Other phenotypes, they're less, some, for example, well-being, a child's perception of their well-being is much less under genetic control and much more under environment. So, and I won't go into the details of this particular slide, but what it shows to us is that, so these are what's called bivariate heritabilities. It's the extent to which the same genes contribute to the correlation between exam performance and each one of these measures. So you can see that the correlation between exam and intelligence is largely genetic of origin. And then correlation, let's say, between health and exam performance is very low, but also largely explained by overlapping genes. So what these genes are doing, it's not clear. But what is clear is that they are a big part of the individual differences in all of these phenotypes. Okay, just I have very little time, so I'll just tell you a couple of other just pointers to what kind of other work one can do to have an informative, genetically informative design. You don't actually need to have twin samples. So this is our very latest branch of work, which I was very fortunate to have through my Russian collaboration. So, one of the former republics of the Soviet Union is Kyrgyzstan, so it's an independent country now. And Kyrgyzstan is very interesting for many different reasons. It's unfortunately, it's one of the poorest nations in Central Asia, so it's the second poorest nation in Central Asia. And it has two ethnic populations there. So one is Kyrgyz, so that's a majority population, and they are kind of genetically very similar to Uzbek and Afghan populations, Central Asian. And another population, Dungan, is a minority, but there are a lot of them. And they are ethnically Chinese, so they're actually migrants from China, from, so these are Dungan, and our Chinese colleagues say they look exactly like Chinese. So they have preserved kind of very interesting, unique culture. They speak a very interesting language, so Dungan language is very interesting, so it's a kind of a tritonal variant of Mandarin Chinese. But they don't write in hieroglyphs or characters, they write in Cyrillics. So they actually write Dungan language in Cyrillics and they undergo Russian educational system. So it's a very, very interesting comparison population. And so there you can test lots of hypotheses if the studies are done well. So you can, for example, you all probably know that Chinese populations show an advantage in mathematical, different mathematical phenotypes. And one of the questions we have is, for example, can we see the advantage of Dungan children over Kyrgyz children? They live in exactly the same environment, they go through the same educational system, they have this low socioeconomic status. And so the comparison between these two populations is very interesting. So, for example, if Chinese advantage can be explained by genetic factors, we could see it in Dungan children. If Chinese advantage comes from the spoken Chinese, we could potentially see it in Dungan children. If Chinese advantage has something to do with spatial nature of their character writing, then we shouldn't see it in Dungan children, etc. So we just started this work and we published this paper with my PhD student, Maya Rodic, and what we showed, we compared several populations. So we have Chinese children, UK children, Dongan, Kyrgyz, and Russian. And what we showed is that although on many different factors, like early 5-year-olds, we had that, on speed of processing, on number sense, etc., we showed no difference between these populations. We did show differences in early arithmetic, in that Chinese 5-year-olds were outperforming all our other children, and there were no differences between Kyrgyz and Dongan children. So at least the kind of genetic explanation for a Chinese advantage in this, at this age, in this phenotype, was not shown. And then we hypothesized, and neither were they spoken Chinese. So we then hypothesized that perhaps the exposure to complex Chinese characters could explain some of the Chinese advantage at this age. And we did this other study, which was a kind of pilot study, and it just came out. And what we did, we used Russian children. Russian children start learning a second language at different ages. In the second grade of school, and they can choose. Their parents can choose where to send their children, and they can learn English or German or whatever, and they can learn Japanese or Chinese. And so we hypothesized that perhaps learning Chinese as a second language offers some kind of advantage for mathematical and spatial ability. And so this study, as I said, was pilot because it's only run for 1 year so far. And what we showed is that after 1 year, we had this excellent comparison of Russian children who studied different languages. And we showed some very marginal indication, actually, that our Chinese learning group has had a marginally better mathematical and spatial performance than other children. But the differences were quite small, and so it really needs follow-up, this study. So that's a kind of genetically and otherwise informative studies. So I have only 5 minutes, so I'll just tell you very few words about molecular genetics. So here, we can see Chinese children sleeping during class, and so they're clearly not genetically related in terms of like family members, but their culture makes them behave similarly. We have monozygotic twins who are genetically identical, and they behave more similar than other people on many different things. We have lots of twins. Do you think these are twins? Do you think these are?
No.
No? Good. Okay, so these are twins. These are dizygotic twins, and you can see they're much more different than monozygotic twins. They really are no more similar genetically than brothers, sisters, and any sister. And these two guys are not twins, so they're actually different age and everything. And they just discovered them each other by chance recently. Just people were referring to one as the other, and then they met on the bus. And why do you think they're similar? They are actually very similar. And not only physically, although they're slightly different age, but in many other ways. They are both teachers, they did a lot of things at the same, they married at the same age, etc. Why do you think that is? No? No, they grew up in a similar region, but they are similar because just by chance they share more genes than random people. And I'm sure you have that many times. You bumped into somebody who just reminds you of somebody else. They just look exactly like somebody else. They move like somebody else, etc. And that's because, remember, we are practically identical clones, all of us. We are 99.9% similar genetically. We have identical DNA. Except for 1% of DNA is a lot of differences. It's actually millions of differences in our DNA. But just by chance, some people are just a little bit more similar than random, and other people are just a little bit less similar than random. And so now we have this, for the first time in just a few years, this particular analysis appeared. It's called genome-wide complex trait analysis, that allows you to extract heritability of a particular trait right from DNA, with no twins, no adoption, no nothing, just from DNA, just by having a large number of people and comparing their DNA for these millions of markers, just to see whether if you and I are just a little bit more similar genetically, are we also a little bit more similar behaviorally? And so these studies confirm what we've learned from twin studies, that genes contribute to practically everything, just like environments do. And very importantly, that there is not one gene, not two genes, not 10 genes, not 100 genes that contribute to, let's say, mathematical variability. But hundreds and possibly thousands of genes contribute to each of these phenotypes. What we've learned recently is that traits are what we call polygenic. It's multiple DNA markers contribute to every trait. And therefore, here I'll just show you this. And therefore, it's been very, very difficult to find these genes. So we know they're there. We know this from twin studies, from GCTA studies. We know that heritability of everything is high. So why can't we find these genes? Well, because if there are hundreds of genes contributing to every trait, each one of them is making only a tiny contribution. So we are lagging behind. We haven't found many genes. But in 2010 already, each one of these dots is a replicated association between a specific DNA marker and a particular trait. And so things like relevant to us, for example, cognitive function, conduct disorder, etc. So we found genes for these traits, but together they don't explain these traits. We need to find many more markers. So this study just last year found several DNA markers that are associated with cognitive performance. So we can now take them and understand what they do in the brain. So this is another of our studies that attempted to do that. And so I'll finish just with this one thought, that it has become known as the missing heritability problem. So we know that traits are heritable, but we can't find the genes. So it's like we are looking, we thought that we will find major genes, a gene for schizophrenia, a gene for mathematical genius, a gene for this and that. That didn't happen. It's because we are looking for multiple, they're called QTLs, multiple DNA contributors to these different traits. Difficult to find. But the methodology is developing so rapidly that there is no doubt that we will find more and more genes. So in 2003, when the human genome has been sequenced for the first time, it took 2,000 researchers, 5 years, $3 billion to sequence sequence the DNA of one person. And today we can do it for less than one day for $20,000. There is a prediction that just in a few years it will cost $100 to sequence DNA of every person. And there is another prediction from Francis Collins, who is just recently director of NIH in the States, that very soon a newborn DNA will be sequenced at birth. So this will present an enormous wealth of data for further research and understanding all of these processes. So I think I'll leave you with this, the last thought. So DNA is a text. So I think you here are interested in reading. We heard a lot about reading, etc. So DNA is a text. And it's text full of meanings. And remember, although we have this text in every cell of our body, actually, which part of this text expresses and under which condition depends on many different facts, many different reasons. So, for example, this same sequence of text can read many different things under different circumstances. So when we understand how this text expresses itself in every person, we will really move on with personalized everything. Personalized medicine, personalized education, personalized prediction, prevention, etc. So hopefully, a lot of the time our DNA will be this kind of thing. This can be done today, and not the opposite. So, and really, it is exactly like this. Remember this, for example, this sequence can be in your every cell of your body. But under one circumstance, in one environment, it will read one thing. One part of this DNA sequence will express. And under another environment, completely different text will emerge. So I really do believe that it's a text. It's written in unknown language. So we are very good at decoding it now, but we are very poor at comprehending it. So, and we also know that the meaning of this text depends on context. So our job will be to adjust context so that the meaning is what we want it to be. So let's really understand it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have any questions? I will practice. Okay, so I think thank you very much.
Yeah. Studies in the world, so we are familiar with all kind of questions about group differences, population differences, etc. But remember, and I started with this, behavioral genetics is actually most interested in individual differences within any population. So cross-population differences are less interesting in a way, because average cross-population differences are infinitely smaller than variability that exists within any population. Actually, a microcosm of any variability is a classroom. In one classroom, you might find more variability than average between any populations. And so our main goal is to understand what drives within population variability. These are children who are approximately in the same environment, in the same whatever, and, you know, even genetically identical children can be different. So what drives this variability? That's our main question. Although these cross-population differences are also very informative and interesting. Yeah. Possibly, and therefore that's why you do need collaboration within the countries as well, just to see, and we do. So for example, the study I showed you where we had six different populations of five-year-olds, they were in their own countries, and so it's easy to manage. Yeah. We can talk more later. Thank you.